introduction about ourselves. So EQ Magazine is a leading and we started in January 2009 where our first edition of the monthly magazine came out. So we started with a mission to create awareness about solar energy and its applications, uses. So way back in January 2009 when we started, we've seen those era where the Gujarat policy came out and the solar mission was rolled out, and we've seen tariffs of 18.44, and today we are, we all know what the situation is, that solar is on its way to become the mainstream source of energy, and the immediate future of energy storage, electric vehicles is on the cards. So we are a monthly magazine in the solar space. We have a daily newsletter, we have a news portal, daily updated, where we are covering all news, articles, jobs, tenders, videos, lots and lots of information. Then we are carrying out at least one or two conferences in some part of the country every month. So with great pleasure and pride, I welcome you all for the conference today. Thank you very much for joining us. The first session is definitely very special, and may I take this opportunity to welcome our panelists, Mr. Santosh KM, MD, Enerpac Energy. Sir will be chairing and moderating the session. Mr. Satish Kumar from BESCOM. Mr. V.C. Raghunath, Director, Swelect. Mr. Mahesh Aswathaiya, DGM Business Development from Juwi, India Renewable Energies. And Mr. C.V. Ramana, DGM SBI. As you all know, Bangalore traffic is a little hassle, so hence the delay. And two more speakers actually are going to join us in the next 10 minutes. May I request the panelists to join me for the lamp lighting in the front, please? Gentlemen, let's hear it for our esteemed panelists for the first session. Let's hear it for the progress India is making in the field of solar energy. I'd like to invite Mr. Mohan Kumar, GM Technical CREDL, to make the opening keynote address, and Mr. Santosh G from Enerpac will be the chairing and moderating the session. Thank you very much, sir.
Good morning, everyone, sir. I sincerely thank everyone for having invited me here. My name is Mohan Kumar. I am General Manager Technical from Karnataka Renewable Energy Development Limited, that is CREDL. I would like to tell you a few words what CREDL is doing and what it has done. Though we have so many categories in generating renewable energy, except for wind and solar, the other categories, biomass, cogeneration, and small hydro, it is almost end of the road for them. Because of so many reasons, biomass industry, because of its some field problems, and there is no regulation available for procuring the raw material, and government does not have a control over the rate on the raw material. As you know, gentlemen, biomass industries are not doing well. Obviously, developers are not coming forward to commission more and more biomass. As and today, out of 134 megawatt of biomass commissioned, only small percentage is working. Even some of the industries which are working, they are not working 24/7. So partial. Next is cogeneration. Cogeneration depends mainly on availability of bagasse. That is, in our state, it is almost optimized. We have already 1,385 megawatts of cogeneration plant commissioned in the state. As you know, the cane production year to year, it is almost constant. So we cannot expect a big addition in cogeneration. Coming to small hydro, in the state, we have commissioned 848 megawatt. This is supposed to be the best in the country. But more than 1,000 megawatts has been held up due to court cases in Western Ghats. So we cannot expect a big addition in small hydro also. The remaining is wind and solar. I am proud to tell you, gentlemen, we are the second best in the country as far as wind potential is concerned, with 55,000 megawatts of generation as per National Institute of Wind Energy Studies. Out of which, as of now, we have already commissioned 3,840 megawatts in wind category alone, and we have added 882 megawatt in the year 2016-17, which is all-time record. Out of the 3,800, we have added 882 megawatt, and we have added around 1,000 megawatts of solar, this thing put together. In 2016-17, we have added 1,900 megawatts of installed capacity with respect to the total installed capacity of 7,553 megawatts. We have installed capacity of renewable category 7,553. As per the load curve of one of the particular day, that day the total installed capacity of the state was 18,200 megawatt. With respect to that, we are almost installed capacity, with respect to installed capacity, generation from renewable category is almost 30%. This is second best in the country next to Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu still, they are first. Of course, now I have told you, except for wind and solar, we do not have much option to add from renewable category. Solar, though it has started only 2 years back, but it has picked up very fast. And again, CREDL is proud to announce that we are going to commission the biggest solar park in the world in Pavagada. That is 2000 megawatt. 600 megawatt is going to be commissioned shortly by November, December, and complete 2000 megawatt will be by 2019 January, February, March. So with this, few statistics. I thank everyone for having given me opportunity to introduce CREDL. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Mohan Kumar, for both for bringing out the data that Karnataka has close to 30% generation happening through renewable energy sources, and the enormous strides Karnataka has taken in the last few years to try and improve both the wind and solar ecosystem in the country. Yeah. With this, what I will do now is that we will have a round of introductions of the panelists, and we will have a few questions, three or four discussions on key topics, both covering the solar nationwide as well as solar specific to the state we are in. Post which we can have a question and answer session, and about 11 o'clock we wind up this panel discussion. So I'll start the introductions first by myself. So my name is Santosh. I started in the solar sector in the year 2012. Those times, solar was roughly 22 crore rupees a megawatt DC. And we couldn't really sell solar. We could only try and do emotional sale of solar as something that is good to do, something that saves the carbon footprint, and also piggyback ride on the policies that come on the government side. This continued for a long, long time. So from those prices, solar came all the way down to roughly about 18 crore rupees at around the cusp when India launched its policies in 2010. That was the capital cost of solar PV. There was also another very important thing. India was the leader in solar manufacturing and exports. Contract manufacturing of solar modules was predominantly happening in India, not in China. China never had manufacturing footprint till 2008. And India was exporting to US as well as Europe large quantities of modules. So that was the scenario in my first solar avatar. Subsequently, I have worked in investment side in solar also, where we set up solar plants representing the investor. And from 2012, I am part of Enerpac, which is a German investment company with 1.1 gigawatts of assets and also EPC. And I'm looking after the Indian business. So I would now request the other panelists to introduce themselves, starting with Mr. Raman.
Good morning, everybody. I do not have such a distinguished profile. And I represent State Bank of India here. And like you all know, we still continue to be the largest Indian funder to solar projects. And our view is very bullish. We'd like to take this to a lot of heights, and we do find a lag between policy and implementation, thought and implementation. And maybe that's the way the whole economy is. I wouldn't like to blame just the solar sector for not picking up. It seems to be an endemic ecosystem problem rather than a particular industry-specific problem. However, suffice it to say that State Bank has always been in the forefront, has been best banker for clean and renewable energies, sustainable energies. We have also been recognized by the Government of India as the leading banker to this sector. And we hope to have a very, very long and a very fruitful relationship with the industry. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A very good morning, everybody. My name is Raghunath. I'm working as a director in Swelect Energy Systems. Swelect Energy Systems is erstwhile Numeric Power Systems Limited. We've been in the power sector for more than 30 years, and of which the past 6 years we've been in the solar sector. We are a turnkey solution provider. We are also an OEM, where we manufacture our own modules and MMS and the balance of plant system. Bangalore is our second home, and very happy to be in Bangalore, and very honored to be in a very distinguished panel discussion today. And we wish to have a very fruitful discussion today. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Good morning. Myself, Mahesh. I represent Juwi India. Juwi India is a subsidiary owned by Juwi AG. It's a German-based MNC. We have a global portfolio of more than 4 gigawatt. We are specialized more into wind and solar, out of which solar is also close to 2 gigawatt. In India, we started in 2010, and we are specially focused on project development, EPC, and O&M. Presently we have close to 300 megawatt projects which are under pipeline. And O&M, Juwi India handles around more than 600 megawatt of project portfolio for O&M across APAC region. This is what is Juwi India presently. Now, with respect to today's conference, first of all, I would like to thank EQ, Anand and this team for having provided a platform like this, wherein all the key stakeholders, I really appreciate that we have a government representatives, we have SBI, and we have, I understand there is a session from financiers, developers, manufacturing, technology. It's a great opportunity for us to understand the present needs with all the stakeholders under the same roof, and probably with the ambitions target set by both our Government of India and even Government of Karnataka. And I also take this opportunity to thank Government of Karnataka for having the brought in the best, probably the first solar policy in the country. I think it is well recognized, and most of the states have started following suit. Though we, sir, is claiming that we are second in terms of having achieved our portfolios, but still the sort of initiatives that have been taken has been wonderful. And I look forward to having great interaction today along with the panelists and the distinguished crowd here. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning to all of you. I'm Satish Kumar. I'm a retired general manager from BESCOM. I was instrumental in bringing the solar policy guidelines and other, finalizing the other formats and all. And also I was responsible in bringing the, empaneling for inverters, meters, as well as facilitators. So this empanelment thing, we did it as these inverters were still in the initial this thing, and we wanted to have this on a continuous process instead of we floating a tender. Floating a tender would have actually limited to few of the bidders or vendors, whoever it is. Now it is a continuous process. Who comes out with new concepts or new inverters and all, he can empanel, provided that he produces the relevant test reports. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I just want to start the first discussion with a small preamble. And what we should be speaking about initially, in my opinion, is something to do with what we have achieved so far as a country in terms of solar, what is really preventing us from accelerating this. Prior to that, I would like to welcome Mr. Narasimhan, who is the owner of Raasi. And also, Mr. Narasimhan, you would like an introduction from you as well, sir.
Good morning to all of you. I am Narasimhan, ex-member of parliament from Tamil Nadu, heading the Raasi group of companies Bangalore, and I am heading the Indian Solar Association also. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. So the first topic I want to speak about, and I'll start with a small preamble. In 2010, India literally had a bunch of off-grid solar systems, a thriving manufacturing in solar, both in modules as well as in balance of systems, a predominantly off-grid market, and when the policy started in the utility side, the market shifted. It did not really take off immediately. If you start looking at what happened, the first 3 years, there was more or less a consistent growth, a similar number of megawatts added year on year. The belief in India and the money into India started coming from the fourth year onwards, that is 2014 onwards, in a bigger way. And then it has really taken off last year. Cumulatively, we have done about 16 to 17 gigawatts roughly of installed base. And the target the government has set is 100 gigawatt by 2022. And now there is a little bit of soul searching we need to do. There is an energy potential in India that exists in terms of sunlight, which is immense, no doubt about it. There is also a growing population, and the per capita energy consumption in India is very, very low, which means an average individual can consume at least 4 times more energy than what he or she is doing in order to move up both the human development index as well as eventually in the economy. So when such is the criteria, And the thermal energy as well as conventional energy sectors are decelerated and slowed down to a large extent. Solar certainly has a nice opportunity, no doubt about it. What is preventing India from repeating what China is doing, for example? China installed almost double of what we have cumulatively done in one single year. Yeah? So what prevents India from reaching this potential? There are three or four main things that we probably should speak about in the very first panel discussion. The first is around the hindrances, the bottlenecks. The belief in India is very much there. Money is coming into the country. Predominantly, funding both in debt and equity are available. However, committing money will take four convictions. And there are a few things that might be potentially blocking us from unleashing our potential. Is it something to do with land availability? The park policy should probably address it. Let's speak on that and see how effective that is. Is it something to do with policy consistency? Is there a lack of sight for an investor? An investor can't plan what is going to come in the next 1 year, 1.5 years, so that he or she can deploy the equity and organize the debt. Is it that we don't have a foresight? Policies happen sporadically, and hence there is a bit of a lackluster response. Is it something to do with the recent PPA pushbacks that have been happening in a few states that have led to some dampening of sentiments? Or is it something to do with the trade financing and the module related price uncertainties that also might block the sector? So there are four or five possibilities that may potentially be blocking us. Like any new economy, it has an excellent growth rate, a compounded annual growth rate, which is upwards of 40% if you start looking at from 2010 onwards. But there is also uncertainties that plagues the segment. It is a capital intensive segment. So what I want to start asking the panelists is, what is it needed for India to reach 100 gigawatt by 2022? We need to do a 16 gigawatt every year from next year onwards. That is the sum total of all investments we have done, all installations we have done from 2010 till 17. What we did in 7 years, we should do now every year, the same quantity. Okay, is it feasible? And what does it take to achieve it? So I'll start this first by going to the investing person in this group, Raasi, who have won 100 megawatt recently in Tamil Nadu in the policy. So I guess we should start from the investor's angle first and then go around.
Thank you, Mr. Santosh, and the leaders on the dais. Heartily welcome to all the delegates, those who have taken part here. Good morning to all of you again. I would like to convey my heartfelt thanks to EQ International Group. Hopefully, I think Mr. Anand Gupta and this team might have conducted hundreds of meetings and conferences like this across the country. More than doing the business, more than investing, we need the supporting factor, moral support like these events, through the medias like EQ International. There are so many other people entered in this space, but I believe EQ stands first. So they are also in the solar field. I know their group, I know them. I know what about the talents, how they are going on, keep on happening national, international level. So I would like to congratulate this group for this today's event to be held in Bangalore. At the same time, I would like to request them to have some programs like this to create the awareness among the developers in Tamil Nadu. Mr. Anand Gupta, Tamil Nadu is not an untouchable part to you. So I would like to request you to come and do something in Tamil Nadu. Hope during the concluding section, he will give some of the dates to do something in Tamil Nadu. Hopefully, I would like to welcome again all of you, sir. The top level people, those we gather here on the dais and as well as the people in front of us, really it makes a lot of impression how we are progressing towards the achievable target of Narendra Modi ji's of 100 gigawatt to this country. Sir, all we know very well, we are blessed with 300 sunny days, and as well as southern part also, after Gujarat and Rajasthan, Andhra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, we are having a good sun sunny days. And the attraction for this sector, as earlier I might have told by Mr. Santosh, after BJP came to power, after Narendra Modi assumed as the Prime Minister of India, and Mr. V.S. Goyal has taken up the portfolio of MNRE, and as well as the stalwarts like earlier Tripathi and as well as Tarun Kapoor, all these team, including Ashwini Kumar of SECI, they are the architects for this country to bring this country as a heading for International Solar Alliance. We are proud of that. We are proud of Prime Minister and as well as for bringing International Solar Alliance to this country. Of course, this needs lot of efforts, lot of influence, lot of support from government. As rightly my colleague Ms. Santosh might have told you what is happening in China. It's all not at all comparable. What China is doing, what we are doing. To bring this kind of policy, to take up this country towards the 100 gigawatt target, it has taken a lot of time for us. Policies are created by government and the rulers, and it is implemented by the bureaucrats and the government authorities. And then finally, where it is going to end up to develop the project is by the banker. Hopefully some of the people came from banker side also, hopefully State Bank, other banks, they may have taken part here. They are the key people to support this project because they are the people having money. Every one of the developer, every one of the firm, those who wants to enterprise into solar, they have to live under the mercy of the banker. Today, that is the scenario in this country, whether you accept it or not. So, first of all, my request to bankers, consider the projects under priority scheme. Ms. Santoshi knows, when we won 100 megawatts recently in Tamil Nadu as a 3.47, the lowest bid of Tamil Nadu, how the bankers are pulling us pillar to post. I'm sorry to mention this dais. I'm having the politics that is not doing anything in business. I don't want to mix up politics into business. It's a different concept. If we mix up, we are out on the day. Bureaucrats may not like, bankers may not like, even the business people also may not like. But having both, how we have to survive in this country? This is what before us. We need politics as pickle in the leaf of the food. At the same time, main food is from business. The same policy we are also following. Many people might have thought that he is an XMP, he might have a lot of money made in politics. No. We are making money purely in business and spending money in politics. Santoshi knows, everybody knows of me. So with this concept to grow under the democratic system, today why we have chosen solar? We are into IT, we are into insurance. Today we are into solar nearly about 4 years. The first 701 of the tariff won by us in Tamil Nadu, unfortunately, for the various political reasons, we could not sign the PPS. It's a different thing. At the same time, we were waiting for the opportunity to see that what is the reasonable tariff going to get for us is 3.47 in Tamil Nadu, which is still on the higher side of Gujarat and Rajasthan when you compare the Rewa Park or Badla Park or wherever it is, other parts of the country. Of course, as everybody knows that Tamil Nadu may have some kind of other constraints like political instability, little bit corruption, some scams. Today it's all getting vanished because the government of India is directly watching what is happening in the state of Tamil Nadu into solar and the renewable energy sector. Recently, Tamil Nadu joined in the Uday scheme with the support of Mr. Fees Goyal. Tangedco was a debt-oriented organization. Today, it is getting converted into profit-making organization. And in Tamil Nadu, today, we are getting the support of the tariff to be honored with healthy at the end of the day. Whether they are honest or dishonest, God only knows. But today, what is available? This is the part of Tamil Nadu. Coming to Karnataka, where I partly live in Bangalore, my place is 1 hour journey from here, Krishnagiri and Hosur. I like Karnataka, I love Karnataka. It is not because my mother belongs to Karnataka or my children are living here. Here, the atmosphere is good. Here, the leaders are good. Whether they belong to BJP, whether they belong to Congress, whether they belong to JDS. Of course, beyond all of these things, we are seeing the political stability in Karnataka. So we welcome every of the entrepreneur, every of the proposed entrepreneur to come down and do something into solar and renewable energy sector in Karnataka. The policies are very friendly. The regulators are very friendly. The politicians are approachable and accessible. And it is the doable things are there. So we welcome all of you to do something in Karnataka, sir. Of course, my friend D.K. Sivakumar is not here. Of course, our friend Siddaramaya is supporting. They keep on handling, they keep on conducting various conferences and programs. So in spite of that, I could say that Karnataka want 3,000 megawatts of the Pavagada Park, which is a quite attractive in the southern part of the country. Of course, Chandrababu Naidu is trying to bypass. It is happening because of their own visions. But Karnataka, we have a stable policy. They have a good people. They have got good rulers. And everybody is friendly. People are not only friendly, the administrators are also friendly. That's why all we like Karnataka. So you people are blessed with all these things. Whereas in other states, it's not like that. I was there in Rajasthan 1.5 months back. The Chief Minister Madam asked me, Narsimhanji, why can't you do something in Rajasthan? I asked them to allocate some kind of land for the projects. She said, already many people signed, somebody has run away and some people are keeping the land, they are not doing anything. Today we are crossroads, we are at the crossroads. What happened for the past 3 years into solar, 3.5 years into solar is different. Now currently what we are facing, the situation into solar is totally different, because it is not only for the, it is not because of the policy. It is because of the situation, the circumstances happened to hamper little bit growth of the solar projects. That's why we insist from the day one, everybody knows, under the Indian Solar Association, we given various representation to government and as well as the state governments. Still we are insisting them, the major hampering is even because of low-cost funding is not at all accessible and available. Other than the various big groups, all other entrepreneurs, they have to live under the mercy of the nationalized or any kind of bankers. We got REC, we have got IRIDA, we have got PFC, we have got other organizations to support us beyond the bankers, exclusively for the renewable energy in this country. But in spite of all these institutions, I am not telling this to discourage you. I want to create the awareness among the developers.
So, Mr.
In spite of all these things. Yeah.
So, financing is one thing, sir, for sure, as you pointed out.
I will come back.
What about the policy and the other side?
Yeah, I'm coming there. In spite of all these things, I am requesting the government of India to create an exclusive bank with the low-cost funding available for the developers, whether it should be named as the Renewable Energy Bank or Green Bank. We have got SIDB for what? Small Industries Organization. We got IDB exclusively for what? For the industrial development. Today we have nothing for this other than these four institutions, where the rate of interest is always talked about 9.5% to 11%. So here also, I would request to all the panelists to finalize a resolution insisting government of India to announce an exclusive bank for solar energy projects at the low cost funding, which should not exceed more than 6% to 7% to compete in the world. This is the one. Regarding the policy, from the day one we are talking about the policy. Each and every state government have their own wishes and willingness. Tamil Nadu says, I will support through LC. Karnataka says, I am honoring all the payments in time. And many of the payments are delayed and deferred by various other states. This is because of the DISCOMs, failure of their credit position. They are not so stronger to honor the PPAs. So what we look forward is a viable PPA, bankable PPA. It should be honored by the payers, DISCOMs. It should be supported by the financial institution. More than that, what we need is a proper policy. The policy-wise, we are insisting the government of India, sir, we should have a uniform policy throughout the country. Every state, one policy, one price, one payment mechanism, one discount mechanism. This is not proper. It is creating in among the international investors, It is creating some plus and minus. They got a lot of confusions. Yesterday we had a talk with our Norway guys. Some of the Norway company has invested 197 megawatts day before yesterday into Malaysia. When I was in Malaysia, when I was in Norway, I could see what is happening here and there. But when we invite to India, what they talk, political stability is there, but the policies are differ from state to state. So I would like to request and honor India should have a uniform policy according to radiation available throughout the country. Maybe region-wise, it may be 1 or 2% difference. So we should have a government of India uniform policy throughout the country, one tariff, bankable tariff. That policy should be friendly, avoiding all the constraints of the land banks, grid connectivity, financial support, and as well as coming again the bankable PPAs, and to give all the support exclusively for the solar energy people. Beyond all these things, Ms. Santosh has requested to conclude the speech, but with one point, let me conclude. We are trying to bring an exclusive insurance coverage for all the solar developers in this country. The coverage is for the generation guarantee, which is going to affect us beyond, it is by the natural calamities. Suppose Karnataka is blessed with 300 sunny days, the projections given to bank, the projections given by the developer and to the government is for based on this. Anything goes beyond our control by natural calamities. Every day we are seeing rainy season here. Every day we are seeing more cloudy. With this kind of effects, the generation will be getting affected. To cover this, in this country, if you have anything, even the farmers, if they lose the crop because of the natural calamity, they are covered. So we are advising the government to bring the solar exclusive insurance policy for the generation guarantee as well as for the support from the natural calamities. This will be happening after some time. Ms. Santosh knows, everybody knows well, we are working very aggressively for this. I hope Karnataka, out of 7,000 or 6,000 megawatt they expected, they have done slightly more than 1/4 of that. With all these things, Karnataka is progressing very much because of the supportive policies. Still, if there are any constraints, if there are any loopholes, if there are any more demands, I request all the panelists to prepare a memorandum which we can give it to Honorable Chief Minister and Power Minister of the state, and we can work together to support this. Sir, with all these things, solar is the only best projects where people even at the stage of the retirement also can have a look on this, because this is only going to give you the revenues like a fixed deposit for several years, 25 years like that. So I would like to welcome all of you and as well as to listen to all of you. Let us create something in Karnataka. Let us work together for the progress of the solar energy in Karnataka. Let us bring good revenues to the state and good employment to the state. With the support of skill development departments, definitely Karnataka can look into that. Karnataka can look into more in the manufacturing sector. Already there are some companies manufacturing in a better way, which I would like to request the Karnataka government to this dais to create a value chain from polysilicon to cell and panel with a 1 gigawatt size, at least to cater the requirements of the southern part of India. So we need to encourage the manufacturing sector. We need to bring the solar insurance. We need to bring the low-cost funding. We need to bring the wonderful policies. Karnataka will pioneer in this. We will take the support of all the rulers. We'll go ahead, sir. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. If I've taken more time, I'm very sorry for this. I can interact with you again and again. We want to see that India is going to achieve 100 gigawatts at the time prescribed by Honorable Prime Minister Modi ji, and we would be taking part in the International Solar Alliance as a future stakeholders, as a future participants. I would like to welcome all of you to reach this goal. Thank you very much.